Convocations herald the approaching conclusion of each academic year. As such, they're greeted with a certain amount of satisfaction and expectation that comes from concluding a very significant phase of our and your work. They also give us an opportunity to reflect back, as we should, on the past academic year with a sense of celebration. A lot has been achieved, and in so many diverse disciplines and fields of interest. Students and faculty here have produced superlative work in, I'm going to name just a few, writing, research and service, athletic interests, in outreach to nearby communities, but also outreach to the greater world. In outstanding teaching at the levels of practice teachers and of master teachers. In music composition and artistic performance, in scientific experimentation, in exhibition, in initiatives in innovation. To each of you who has contributed these and other achievements to make Lawrence a strong and a vibrant university this year, we sincerely commend you. I'm now going to ask the students who have been awarded special recognition to stand as I name your areas of expertise or your disciplines. You might want to turn around and face the audience after you stand. If that's comfortable for you, it's certainly friendlier for all of us. Please remain standing until all of the honorees have been called, and then we will recognize you all at once with applause at the end. So, the honors awardees of 2011, please stand in anthropology, art and art history, athletics, biology, chemistry, classics, the Conservatory of Music, East Asian languages and cultures, economics, education, English, foreign languages, geology, government, history, international studies, literature, mathematics, philosophy, physics, psychology, religious studies, theater, Riston and West scholarship recipients, students elected to mortarboard, students elected to honor societies, and all other award winners in the areas of campus life, community and global community service, and all other awards in the areas of scholarship and creativity, please stand. Congratulations to all of these students. Done, everyone. Congratulations. Will the faculty and staff who've been recognized for their contributions to the quality of the Lawrence education, including excellence in teaching freshman studies and mentoring students in community engaged learning, please stand and be congratulated. Way to start. Congratulations, everyone, and now it's my pleasure to introduce today's speaker who will address you, and it's a special privilege to welcome her back. This is one of Lawrence's own distinguished graduates. We're especially pleased to welcome someone as accomplished as Dr. Sara Quandt, who knows the things about honors herself. She graduated summa cum laude for her senior independent project in 1973 from Lawrence. Anthropology major? Who was your advisor?
John Hickman.
John Hickman, anthropology major. Welcome back. For nearly three decades, Dr. Quandt worked tirelessly toward raising public consciousness about the health inequities and social justice challenges faced by rural and minority populations, particularly immigrant farm workers. She has devoted much of her career to assessing the root causes of these problems and rectifying them through the establishment of partnerships and providing resources and educating the public. Dr. Quandt, whose grandparents were tobacco and subsistence crop farmers in North Carolina, co-founded and serves as a member of the advisory board of the North Carolina Field Coalition, an organization that works on issues ranging from ending child labor in agriculture and eliminating food scarcity among farm worker communities to providing dignified housing for migrant farm worker families. Since joining the faculty of the Wake Forest University School of Medicine in 1994, Professor Quandt has applied her professional interests in community-based research, medical and nutritional anthropology, and social gerontology to many of that school's specialized departments. These include the Maya Angelou Center for Health Equity, the Center for Diabetes Research, and the Women's Health Center of Excellence Research, Leadership, and Education. She currently serves as the Associate Director for Translation and Education at the Center for Worker Health at the Wake Forest Baptist Medical Center. Her success as a scholar and researcher is reflected in a prodigious volume of publications and appointments, including authoring or co-authoring chapters of 20 books and nearly 200 journal articles, delivering more than 100 invited lectures and presentations, and serving as a member of the editorial boards of 10 academic journals, among them the Journal of Nutrition for the Elderly. Her efforts have been recognized with awards from the National Rural Health Association, the National Institute for Occupational Safety and Health, and the Washington Association of Professional Anthropologists, as well as by the Wake Forest University School of Medicine, which honored her with its Outstanding Senior Faculty Research Award. But please join me in warmly welcoming, back to her alma mater, Dr. Sara Quandt.
President Beck, faculty and students, I am truly honored to have been asked to address you today for the Honors Convocation. When I attended Lawrence almost 40 years ago, convocations were not as regular a part of campus life as they seem to be today. But I do remember very clearly that every year began with the matriculation convocation. And some of us used the distinctiveness of the academic regalia to try to envision where we'd go to graduate school. In retrospect, it seems particularly surprising to me that we were so smitten by caps and gowns and hoods, as the early 70s were marked by a rejection of anything that smacked of hierarchy and authority. We didn't trust anyone over 30. We somehow managed to have many of the distribution requirements for majors thrown out, and we made caps and gowns optional for our own graduation. So this is the first time I've worn a gown, not even a cap, at Lawrence. But somewhere between the matriculation convocation and commencement, Lawrence had a profound effect on me. I was not, as some of my convocation speaker predecessors have said, I was not a party animal while I was at Lawrence. Nor was I an outspoken campus leader. And when, as President Beck mentioned in my introduction, I graduated summa cum laude, even my closest friends and the faculty members who knew me best were utterly shocked. I think it is safe to say that I spent 4 years under the radar, but something about my education here must have set a trajectory that I followed afterwards. I suspect it was that I learned to think critically, to systematically observe the world around me, and to ask questions. Probably the most significant experience I had was carrying out a senior honors thesis project. I somehow landed on the topic of investigating risk-taking behavior in children. And with lots of encouragement, but really very little substantive help from my advisors, John Hickman and Richard Polnack, I set off on what was to be my first field research experience, collecting an enormous amount of data from children in an elementary school here in Appleton. When it came to analyzing it, I had my first experience with multivariate statistics using a computer. We had to go to the Institute of Paper Chemistry across the river to use the computer. And the only time it was available was midnight. And we actually sat at the console of the mainframe computer and fed in punch cards to get the analysis. But I was hooked on the powerful experience of asking a question about human behavior and collecting the data that could unlock the answer. When I was asked to speak today, I was asked to talk about health disparities, which is an area on which most of my work focuses. It was not until I began to prepare for my talk and I was killing time looking at old convocation titles online that I realized that health is really very rarely a topic for a convocation here. But I also realize that many speakers have focused on issues that are key to the things that I want to talk about today in public health. These speakers have focused on race, on gender, on politics, and on human rights. So my goal in this talk today is to try to show how these issues figure into a crisis in health today. I'll focus on the U.S., but this issue is one that characterizes the health of many populations beyond our borders. This crisis has come to be called health disparities. When it's defined by official agencies like the National Institutes of Health, health disparities are said to be differences in the presence of disease or health outcomes across population segments. These health disparate population segments can be defined by factors like race and ethnicity or by socioeconomic status. Put simply, health in the United States today is defined by haves and have-nots. It is a gap that mirrors distribution of wealth and poverty and power and powerlessness. And it's a gap that is growing, it's not shrinking. To talk about health disparities, I'm going to use several case studies as illustrations. All of these cases come from the research my colleagues and I have done. And then I'll try to show how collaboration within and between two communities is necessary to move towards solving these problems. The first community is the community of scholars and scientists, and the second community is the one in which we live. I will particularly concentrate on communities of color, and then I want to close by arguing that as graduates with liberal arts educations, you will be particularly qualified to bring insight to develop innovation solutions for, and we hope, to eliminate health disparities. So let me introduce you to three people whose lives intersect with the research my colleagues and I conduct. I could have chosen to talk about elderly residents in Appalachia or some of the multi-ethnic communities in North Carolina where I've done aging research. But today I've chosen to talk about Latino immigrants whose stories exemplify the issue of health disparities. So the first is Juan Martinez. Juan Martinez works on a tobacco farm in eastern North Carolina. He came to North Carolina last week on an H-2A guest worker visa. He was recruited by a labor contractor in his hometown in southern Mexico to come to the U.S. and work for a grower who claimed that he was in need of laborers. Although Juan had to pay his own bus fare, the contractor promised him at least 30 hours of work a week at a rate of $9.30 an hour, far exceed anything he could make in Mexico. He would have housing, and if he stayed the summer, he would be reimbursed for his travel and get a bus ticket home. As he looked around his impoverished village and considered the future of his children, how could he not do this? So here he is in North Carolina. The grower has provided a barracks in which Juan lives with 18 other workers whom he's never met before. He has no idea where he is. To get to the barracks, they drove over rutted roads far back into the fields where there are no other houses or roads in sight. All you can see is tobacco. The workers all sleep in the same room, and they share a bathroom with two shower heads and three toilets, all lined up with no dividers to provide even the minimum of privacy. It's nothing like home, but he knows he's there to work and send money back to Mexico. So the next day he starts to work. The grower picks up the workers in an old school bus when it's still dark and takes them to a remote field in which tobacco grows shoulder high and rows planted so close together that it is impossible to walk between them without dew-colored leaves drenching the workers. Juan's coworkers show him how to bend low and break off only those tobacco leaves that are ripening and turning yellow. They tuck them under their arms and they run squatting down the row as fast as they can. It's hard to keep up, but Juan knows the grower is watching to see if he can do it, and he's determined. By the end of the day, he has the hang of it. He's sore from the awkward posture, and his clothes and hands are sticky with tobacco juice. He's exhausted, but he feels some sense of satisfaction at having made it through the first day. But that night, things change. He starts to feel dizzy, as though he's drunk, but he hasn't been drinking. His head pounds, and he's so nauseous he can't eat the dinner the others have cooked, and he vomits until he is weak. He is wide awake all night, just wired, unable to sleep. How in the world is he going to be able to work and send money home when he can't eat and he can't sleep? The whole plan of coming to the U.S. seems to be falling apart. But he's not the only farm worker with problems. Francisca Herrera works for an agribusiness corporation called AgMart. She lives in Florida, but in the spring and summer, she migrates up to eastern North Carolina, where AgMart has over 1,000 acres growing grape tomatoes. You'll see those tomatoes in your grocery store here in Wisconsin, and the company markets them in a clear plastic box so you can see that they are perfect. They are uniform in size and color, they are blemish-free, and there's not a spot on them from mold or insects. Working in the tomatoes requires long hours, and unlike Juan, Francisca is not paid by the hour, but she's paid by the bucket of tomatoes she picks. She gets 40 cents for every 32-pound bucket. The more she picks, the more she makes, so there's incentive for her to spend long hours in the field. And since there's no pay on the day when it rains and she's out sick, she knows she has to work. And she thinks she's pregnant, so she may not be able to come to North Carolina to work next year. Working in the fields is hot and exhausting, but the work is made even more unpleasant by the mists that drift from adjacent fields, where workers drive tractors through the tomato plants that pull big tanks of chemicals with boom sprayers behind them. The sprayers leave an acrid, strong smell, and the mist soaks the workers' clothing. Sometimes the tractor gets so close the chemicals are sprayed directly onto the workers. But it's all part of the job, and no one has ever told Francisca that it could be dangerous. But she will find out differently. In early January, back in Florida, Francisca's baby is born, and the baby boy has no arms and no legs. Within the next several months, two other babies of women in the same community are born with different but equally devastating birth defects, and one of the babies dies soon after birth. The third person I'll tell you about is Guadalupe Hernandez, and she's 24 years old, and she lives in Winston-Salem, North Carolina, where I live. Winston-Salem's a city about three times the size of Appleton. Guadalupe moved to North Carolina from Mexico 2 years ago with her boyfriend, and she worked in a factory until her daughter was born 6 months ago. And since then, she's been cleaning houses for a local company. But a few weeks ago, she lost that job. With the bad economy, few people can afford to pay someone else to do their house cleaning. The cupboard in her kitchen is nearly bare. The shelf has 4 cans of salmon, a box of cake mix, a few cans of vegetables. Her freezer has a big bag of tater tots, and a jug of apple juice sits in the refrigerator, and that's all. A reporter comes to interview her for a story on the increasing level of hunger in North Carolina, and she tells him that her wallet is empty except for a few pennies. This week, her utilities were cut off. A friend told her that a local ecumenical ministry called Crisis Control would help her out, and she got some emergency money to get her power turned back on. And then she returned to the ministry and got 4 sacks of food. She told the reporter, "I'm so happy because today I know we will have something to eat." The reporter wants to take her picture, and she lets him, although she's really embarrassed. She knows she has gained a lot of weight since coming to the U.S., and she doesn't know why. When her picture appears in the paper, readers go online to comment, and they comment not on her hunger, but on her obesity, suggesting that maybe the reason she has no money is she's eating too many burgers, and she should go and find herself some fruits and vegetables. These 3 cases appear unrelated. One's a man who does work and gets sick after working in tobacco. Another is a farm-working woman who migrates up the East Coast doing farm work, and she has a baby with severe birth defects. And the third is a mother living in a city who cannot feed her family and paradoxically has become obese. Yet these 3 people have several circumstances in common. The first is that they're all experiencing health situations that they do not understand. Juan works in tobacco and he has no idea why he's getting so dizzy and nauseous. Francisca has no idea why her son was born with those birth defects, because nobody else in her family has ever had anything like that. And Guadalupe knows she was not fat in Mexico, and she can't understand what's happened here, because there are a lot of days she just doesn't eat anything. Beyond that, all three are experiencing health problems that are really due to broader cultural, structural issues that have come to characterize the health of the U.S. population. And these issues are largely not medical, they're political and they're economic. Finally, all three are experiencing health problems that would not have been understood in years past and may not even have received notice. But now that they're being examined through the lens of transdisciplinary team science and community-based participatory research, they're much better understood today and being recognized as really health problems. So I want to go back and examine these cases to talk about the scientific research that our team has contributed and how it has developed through redefining how medical research and community research are conducted. Juan, who works in tobacco, is experiencing what's called green tobacco sickness. What this is acute nicotine poisoning. Nicotine is a compound that's both water and fat soluble. So any water on the plants, whether it's dew or rainwater or sweat from the workers, is full of nicotine. And when it touches the skin of workers, it's very readily absorbed. The large dose of nicotine then sets off a physiologic cascade of events that lead to the symptoms that Juan has experienced. The effects of nicotine poisoning by themselves are clearly unpleasant, but they're not life-threatening. Except in the context of the heat and humidity where workers work very long hours 6 days a week. And there's a very good chance of suffering heat stroke. And heat stroke is a condition that kills farm workers every summer. Green tobacco sickness is a condition for which my colleagues and I have the dubious distinction of now being the world experts. In 1996, we were approached by some healthcare workers who run clinics for migrant farm workers and asked to try to study the problem. These healthcare workers said it was some kind of a skin problem and the workers were allergic to tobacco. So we started reading the literature like good academics. What we found was not very much was known. There were a few case studies scattered in the literature, there were reviews of the case studies, there were reviews of the reviews. In total, there were about 30 papers that didn't say very much. And none of them made a direct connection to nicotine. So we started to involve the community of farm workers and farmers. We talked to anyone we could about how tobacco is grown and harvested and how people work in the fields. Sometimes this meant going to meetings of growers and migrant workers, and sometimes it meant talking to the secretaries in our office. Many of whom had grown up in tobacco farms and had been sick working as kids in the field. I talked to my own mother, who could remember her days on a tobacco farm in the 1920s and 30s, and to her brother and brother-in-law, who until their deaths a couple of years ago, spent their whole lives growing tobacco. What I learned turned out to be the key details of unlocking green tobacco sickness and connecting it with nicotine. For example, I learned that the workers pick the leaves, put them under their arms, and the juice from the leaves coats their underarms. I started to read about nicotine metabolism and learned that chemicals are absorbed at different rates in different parts of the body. But the skin of the underarm is one of the best at absorbing chemicals. Putting all of this information together, we were pretty much convinced that green tobacco sickness was, in fact, due to nicotine. So we got some funding from the CDC and studied the problem. We put together members of the second community, and that is the community of scholars and scientists. We had anthropologists like myself, we had physicians who could develop a differential diagnosis so we could tell green tobacco sickness from food poisoning. We had statisticians who could tease apart the effects of heat and the effects of tobacco. We had chemists who would develop techniques for measuring very small amounts of nicotine metabolites in very small amounts of saliva. And over the course of the summer, we followed a couple hundred workers collecting spit samples all summer long. They knew us when they saw us coming. and asking workers about what they did and how they attempted to protect themselves. At the same time, we interviewed growers and workers about how they thought green tobacco sickness worked. What we were after is what anthropologists call explanatory models of disease, how they explained it. What we found was clear-cut evidence that absorbing nicotine, starting with small amounts in the early summer and progressing to larger amounts later in the summer, was very clearly tied to the symptoms. The more nicotine you had in the body, the worse your symptoms. What we found was that at the beginning of the summer, non-smoking workers had no nicotine in their system. But by the end of the summer, you would have thought they were heavy smokers. They had that much nicotine. Now, in talking with the workers and growers, we got two different sides of this story. Growers thought it was kind of an inconvenience. It was almost a rite of passage to work in tobacco and get sick. But for workers, it was something entirely different. It meant that they had no idea what was wrong with them. They knew that it would make a difference between providing for their family and not. Some workers were so sick and scared that they left the farms, they forfeited their summer wages, and the money they would have been paid out to travel to the US and back. And they basically went AWOL. The questions we asked ourselves were, first, what could be done to protect workers? And second, why had nobody else done this research? We're not that creative. On the question of protecting workers, the most obvious solution, of course, was to stop growing tobacco. But that's not going to happen anytime soon. Tobacco is grown all over the world. I get emails from people in China and India and Brazil and Zimbabwe and Malawi. Everybody's growing tobacco. Its production is very tightly controlled by powerful multinational corporations, and tobacco addiction rates don't seem to be slacking off anytime soon. But educating workers about what causes green tobacco sickness and suggesting protecting themselves from wet leaves by changing out of wet clothes to dry ones that aren't infused with nicotine seems like a pretty low-tech, easily implemented solution. And so to do this, we partnered with yet more colleagues who are health educators and media experts to produce video and low literacy print materials to inform farm workers of exactly what they were experiencing and what they could do about it. The second question, why no one had done this research before, was a little more complex. We suspect that part of the problem is that tobacco production in the United States has changed. Agronomists, other scientists that we don't work with, have determined that planting tobacco in very tight rows, exactly the things that are the issue that exposes workers, increases the nicotine content in the plant. And that's what the tobacco companies want. So that's how the plants are planted now. The other thing that's changed is that up until about 30 years ago, tobacco production was controlled by the government. And growers owned a very small allotment of how many pounds of tobacco they could produce each year. And that meant that tobacco was grown on small family farms with small acreages. Today, that allotment system is gone, and growers can grow as much as they think they can sell. They've consolidated farms into very large acreages, and they have to hire workers to work in tobacco all day, every day, all summer long. Unlike family members who may be able to take a break when they get sick, these workers have no choice. They have to work to be paid, and they're here to make money. If they don't work, they risk being sent home. But probably the easy answer to the question of why no one had studied green tobacco sickness before, and perhaps the answer we knew when we started out, was that green tobacco sickness is a condition of poor people all around the world. Poor people grow tobacco and work in it. Tobacco producers have never been the ones to get rich off cigarettes, and their field workers even less so. So with limited power, these workers lack the information and the ability to change their situation. The story of our work with green tobacco sickness would end there, except for a priest in Milwaukee. Sometime in 2009, I got a call out of the blue from a Father Michael Crosby. I looked him up on the internet. He was real. He is a priest in the Capuchin order, and he works to make large corporations more socially responsible. He called to tell me that he was introducing a motion at the stockholder meeting of Philip Morris, one of the largest tobacco producers. And this motion was to require Philip Morris to create human rights protocols for the company itself and for the growers who supply its tobacco to protect workers from green tobacco sickness. He wanted me to edit the motion to make it scientifically correct, which I did. His action caused Philip Morris to develop and execute a plan to provide educational materials to the growers worldwide and to require green tobacco sickness education for workers be added to the practices that Philip Morris requires of its growers. So we've provided tens of thousands of copies of our materials for these efforts. So that's my story of green tobacco sickness. Let me tell you a little bit what's going on with Francisca. Francisca, with her severely impaired baby, provides what epidemiologists call a sentinel event. That is, it's a sudden, unpredicted occurrence that indicates a much larger problem. It's the canary in the coal mine. When this baby was born, word spread quickly through the farmworker advocacy and research community. And many of us knew all too well that this was the event we had seen in the making for years. The way my team and I got into farmworker research in the first place was a request to work with a community-based organization that helps farmworkers with everything from immigration issues to wage theft issues. They were trying to understand the exposure to pesticides that farmworkers experience and find ways to prevent it. The U.S., with its large-scale commercial agriculture and agribusiness, has the distinction of applying over a billion, with a B, pounds of pesticides every year. This is an effort to produce the crops that the food industry markets to the U.S. population and to the world as a whole. These billion pounds of pesticides just in the U.S. are almost a quarter of what is applied worldwide. Now, pesticides used in the U.S. have changed dramatically over the past 40 years. They no longer cause the environmental degradation described so vividly for DDT in Rachel Carson's book, Silent Spring. Today's pesticides are designed to be non-persistent, meaning they're designed to degrade within a few days of being applied. Nonetheless, they're still poisons. They're meant to kill things. And many of them are what are called neurotoxin that act by disrupting the communications between nerve cells and within nerve cells. The process of regulating pesticides for use in the United States requires no safety studies before pesticides are put on the market. And the safety data collected after they're on the market is usually only for a single pesticide. Even if laboratory animal studies are conducted to examine pesticide safety, still, only a single pesticide is looked at a time. Unfortunately, in the real world, people, particularly farm workers, are exposed to cocktails of pesticides, mixtures of several types that interact and amplify each other's effects. Francisca's case brought to light how dangerous pesticides can be, especially when pregnant women are exposed early in pregnancy. That period is particularly sensitive for the developing fetus. In the investigation after her baby was born, the company Agmart was found to have committed multiple violations. They were spraying the fields when workers were present. They were ordering workers back into the fields while the pesticides were still active. They were applying pesticides three times more often than the law allowed. And perhaps worst, they were intentionally ignoring state pesticide regulations because the company felt it was less expensive to pay the fines than to obey the regulations. In the 3 months before conception and the first trimester of pregnancy, Francisco was exposed to 14 different pesticides, five of which are known to cause birth defects in laboratory animals. Unfortunately, the company received just a slap on the wrist. Hundreds of charges were filed, the state deliberated for 4 years, they supported only 6 charges, and the company was fined $3,000. While Francisca's baby is a very dramatic and tragic example of what pesticides can do, we are just starting to understand that most pesticide effects are subtle. Studies with farmers and farm workers show that cognitive function, memory, decision making, suffer with pesticide exposure. A remarkable set of 3 studies were published simultaneously last month, and they followed mothers and children of farm workers, as well as mothers and children living in cities until the children were 7 years old. All these studies found that the children were normal and healthy at birth. But by 7 years later, prenatal pesticide exposure was very clearly associated with lasting deficits in IQ and other measures of child development. Clearly, pesticides are not, as farmers have told us, so safe you can drink them. Our work on pesticide really doesn't focus so much on the effects they can have. There's no doubt about that. Instead, we concentrate on how workers can be protected from pesticides. In this area, we work closely with farm worker organizations, one of which Dr. Beck mentioned this morning. And a lot of those are made up of current and former farm workers. And they have a unique understanding of the situation that workers face. For example, they can tell us that recommendations to workers to wash the pesticide residues off their hands before eating in the fields really are not going to work because the growers don't provide water. And that despite workers pooling their money to buy a washing machine to have clean, pesticide-free work clothing every day, the grower confiscates it because water is just that expensive. We also work with advocates who work to change government policies to help workers. And we've developed a wide variety of bilingual and low literacy educational programs to empower workers to protect themselves and their families from pesticide exposure. The teams we've used for our research on pesticides are more varied than those for green tobacco sickness. In addition to anthropologists and statisticians and physicians, we regularly partner with toxicologists, analytical chemists, experts on human development, geographers, health educators, and lawyers. Toxicologists and chemists have really been the key. When we started off doing this research, there were pesticides being used for which no assay existed. So there was no way to prove whether or not people were exposed to these pesticides. Fortunately, what I have no idea how to do, chemists think is an interesting project, and we now have assays to help us with that. Guadalupe's story doesn't involve agriculture, but focuses on what is called food insecurity. A food insecurity is kind of a hard term to sometimes wrap your mind around, but what it is a lack of a reliable and safe supply of food that is socially and culturally acceptable. That is, dumpster diving is not a socially and culturally acceptable way to get food. In North Carolina, as well as nationally, there has been this paradoxical rise in obesity at the same time that people are experiencing food insecurity. So why is it that people like Guadalupe, who don't have enough to eat, who even skip meals, become obese? The simple but very incorrect observation that confuses correlation with causation says that somehow programs like food stamp benefits and free school lunches cause obesity, thus showing we really don't need a government-sponsored food safety net. As an anthropologist, I've worked to document levels of food insecurity in a lot of hard-to-reach populations, such as immigrants. And I've tried to focus on trying to understand the experience of food insecurity in an effort to critically examine this public discourse on food and food security. The public discourse says that immigrant families are here to have anchor babies and collect public welfare benefits. My research with families such as Guadalupe indicates that, in fact, this is not the case. Families do not come here intending to collect public benefits. In fact, they don't even know they exist. Rather, they come here to work, and most plan to return to their homes abroad. When they cannot feed their family, they often turn to low-cost but high-calorie foods. The next time you go to the store, compare the cost of a gallon of milk and the same amount of soda. Or compare the energy you'll get from a dollar's worth of cookies and a dollar's worth of carrots. These are hard choices to make, but for family with limited foods and hungry children, the choices are soda and cookies, not carrots and milk. It simply doesn't make sense in feeding your family. As an anthropologist, I've been able to gather parents' stories. Many of them are heartbreaking. The experience that immigrant families relate help to explain the growing problem of obesity. They argue that including more immigrants, not fewer, on the rolls of food stamps and other assistance programs is the way to go. Doing so would likely prevent obesity and the chronic diseases like diabetes that follow. Yet when I have argued that, and the responses are usually swift, vitriolic, and anonymous. After publishing a paper that our team wrote on immigrants' experiences of hunger, two responses stand out. The first was a message I received on my office voicemail saying, "You may think those Mexicans in North Carolina are hungry, but you should come up here to Virginia and see them Mexicans in their Cadillac Escalades with their fat children and their pregnant wives buying steaks with their food stamps." The second was a comment about my paper posted on an anti-immigrant blog, and it said quite simply, "Sometimes the only way to change a liberal's mind is to put a bullet through her brain." And I have to say, I had no response when I saw that, but my husband announced he'd be walking a few paces behind to stay out of the line of fire. But that's what happened. It's clear that one of the common features of the three people I spoke about is that they're all workers. Francisca and Juan are working in agriculture. Guadalupe is working as a service worker. As workers, they're caught up in a global economic and political system that exploits their ability to work and their willingness to do the jobs that nobody else wants to do. At different times in U.S. history, such workers have been white, they've been black, they've been Haitian, and now, largely, they are Hispanic. In all cases, they've been economically disadvantaged, and they have been socially marginalized. 60 years ago, in 1951, President Harry Truman had a commission on migratory labor that examined migrant farm worker conditions nationwide. And they concluded that what held the migrant labor system together was human misfortune. They said, "We depend on misfortune to build up our force of migratory workers. And when the supply is low because there's not enough misfortune at home, we rely on misfortune abroad to replenish the supply." It shocks me to realize that this statement actually was made the year I was born, and it is still true today. And it applies not only to farm laborers, but to those in the service industry, in construction, in food processing, and even in our healthcare system. In all of these industries, work-related injuries and illnesses, and even deaths, are greater among people of color and people who are economically disadvantaged. The percentage of Hispanic workers killed every year has risen dramatically, even as the percentage of white workers killed has dropped. And chances are, these work-related injuries are going to get even worse. While those of us in public health argue that no one should have to get hurt or sick to make a living, there are significant efforts going on in the states and at the federal level to roll back worker protections. There are child labor laws that are being revised, and some of these changes are removing the funding for the very government employees that enforce the existing worker health and safety regulations. But how do we eliminate the health disparities I've described here? Clearly, there needs to be political will to change the situation. And nationally, we need to assert that good health is a human right. And as many times as my colleagues and I would like to go to Washington or to company boardrooms and shake things up, that's not likely going to have very much of an effect. So I said at the outset the two communities are really necessary to address these problems, and I want to return to that. The first necessary step is to work with affected communities so their voices are heard and so that the scientific evidence is set in a compelling and accurate context. This approach is called community-based participatory research, and some investigators here at Lawrence have engaged in this. What it means is that communities and researchers are equal partners, and that's not easy. I am acutely aware that when I partner with community organizations, I have privilege and power. I am white, I was born in the United States, I speak English, I have a good job, I'm well educated, all those things, and I have the security of a job with benefits in an air-conditioned building where the plumbing never backs up. In contrast, the community organizations I work with, members largely speak Spanish, they hold multiple jobs, they rely on an unpredictable series of small grants, and they work in very makeshift offices. So even though we share a budget, and on paper we share leadership of projects, we have to work at being partners. We have to spend time together, we have to listen to each other, and we have to acknowledge our biases and our strengths. What my community partners bring to the relationship is an understanding of the health concerns in their community. And they have a sense of the political and social forces that act every day on their community members. Without the community voice, research on community problems or health disparities would be really shallow, grossly out of touch. It would not address the priorities of people's lives. But with the community voice, health research has become far more compelling to policymakers and others in a position to bring about the fundamental changes necessary to eliminate health disparities. After working with affected communities, the next step is that we need to work with a team of scientists and scholars. As the stories I've related demonstrate, teams of researchers need to work together. Complex health problems are no longer going to be solved by solo scholars working in isolation. Health scientists, chemists, historians, political scientists, all these folks are necessary to understand and reduce health disparities. This kind of team science is not the way I was educated in graduate school. It was not the way that I saw people working at Lawrence. It was not the way I saw scientists working in the first jobs that I helped. But the times have changed, and the scientific questions have really changed. And the work I described here is referred to as team science. There are still scientists who work alone or with others trained in their same discipline, but the increasing demand is for scientists, particularly in the health sciences, who are able to work in teams with scientists of other disciplines. As team science has emerged, I think it's clear that not all scientists are comfortable working on teams. But for those of you students today who will work in the health sciences, it is likely that you'll be a member of a transdisciplinary team, and you should think about the qualifications that you'll need to engage in this kind of scientific endeavor. First, you have to develop the confidence and the expertise in your own area, in what you do. And you have to keep developing it even after you leave school. You have to know both the substance and the methods for whatever it is you bring to the table. I learned early on that as a social scientist, there were things that everybody knew I would know. I would know how to do qualitative methods. I would know how to run a survey. I would know foreign languages. And I would know about health beliefs in different populations. Besides that, to hold your own in team science, you have to be willing and able to learn new things, both in your discipline and beyond it. I really didn't know a lot about Latin American health beliefs, but I knew who the key researchers were, and I knew how to find it out. And so I found it out in a hurry. My training in nutrition had given me training in reading and metabolism and so on, so I was able to go into the nicotine literature, into the pesticide literature, and figure out what were the questions to ask. The third qualification, I think, for team science is that you have to learn how to communicate with those who do not share your expertise. This includes both scientists of other disciplines and laypersons. To do this, it's essential to recognize when you're speaking in jargon and when you're speaking in acronyms. And that's difficult for people to do who have focused simply on a single discipline. But eliminating jargon and acronyms from your speech and writing takes some concerted effort, but it's essential to opening up communication. And finally, team science requires that every participant respect the expertise of others. I think this is particularly hard for scientists because we're all used to being the smartest kid in the class. And we're very confident in our ability to master new materials. But taking the time to get to know team members and their training is essential to being able to make the most of a team opportunity. As graduates with liberal arts education, you can be uniquely positioned to contribute to understanding and reducing health disparities through team science. You have the opportunity here at Lawrence to learn how to learn. You've been challenged to work independently and to work one-on-one with your faculty members. You've participated more in seminars than in lecture courses. You have the opportunity to be active, not passive learners. You have the opportunity here to be exposed to a broad range of disciplines. In fact, you probably have to be exposed to them, and to master how to read and write in those disciplines. You have the opportunity to take courses that immerse you in different bodies of knowledge and that are based on a variety of philosophical and theoretical foundations. You also have the opportunity to become comfortable in a diverse community of people. While many of you are probably like me and that you came from schools and communities that were quite homogeneous, Lawrence in Appleton and Lawrence abroad provides you with many opportunities to expand your comfort zone. I want to end today by calling on all of you, not just students, to consider the importance of health disparities for students as you choose careers, as you donate your time as a member of the community, but also for all of you as you choose candidates you're going to vote for in the next elections. Today, more than ever, health is graded across world populations. Between country differences follow differences in gross domestic product, and within countries, health follows a social gradient in every country, with health indicators, all health indicators, mirroring income and wealth. It's imperative that we focus our national efforts on understanding how health is linked to social, political, and economic factors, and on developing understanding of how health, how effective strategies can be developed for our, ensuring that our country finds ways to improve the health of all people. You have a role to play as students and as faculty, and I challenge you to do that.